In the valley behind me, the sleepy Greek town of Ite is about to receive a rude awakening. For the next 3 days, it hosts the Acropolis Rally, round 7 of 14, and so the halfway point of this year's World Rally Championship. For 4 of the last 5 years, the event's been won by British drivers, and after successive 1-2s in Argentina and Cyprus, Colin McRae and Richard Burns will start the Acropolis as favourites.
Greece, however, has a reputation for breaking cars. Despite the fact that the stages were slightly smoother than usual this year, the rocky Greek roads are always tough on suspension. Memories of last year's event include a string of cars running on three wheels, Tommi Makinen memorably losing one of his on camera. For 2001, however, a psychological battle between the two British drivers would add to the already difficult conditions.
Papers back home have been making something of the fact that there's now a needle between you and Colin. How do you see it?
No, there's nothing between me and Colin. You know, Colin did in Cyprus what we would have done in his position. Well, media tend to do that kind of thing.
So you're the best of friends?
Yeah, nothing's changed between us.
You know, the last two rallies has been quite a big threat, and I'm sure he will be this rally as well. This rally is quite a good rally for the Subaru. It's quite fast and flowing. Can be a bit rough, and I'm sure, obviously, Richard's going to have the bit between his teeth now. He's not wanting to be beaten a third time.
There is a bit of a smile playing around your lips. How much of a psychological battle is going on between the two of you?
I don't know. Maybe he's having more trouble with it than I am, but I'm certainly feeling very comfortable at the moment.
He's told us that you're still the best of friends.
Absolutely. You can't beat your friends, who can you beat?
No. Last year, people remember all the cars coming in with three wheels. Do you think that's going to happen again this year?
Everything is possible, but it looks a little bit more smooth now. Of course, when we go second time over the stages, it will be worse, but we have a bit stronger car also now.
After dominating the Rally Catalunya back in March, the Acropolis saw the gravel debut of Citroën Zara, driven by Philippe Bugalski and Thomas Rodstrom.
How good is this car on gravel?
Well, it's difficult to say. I mean, I have done almost 1 year of working now on testing, and from the feeling side it feels good, but you never know when you don't have compete.
Tommi Makinen was still hanging on to a slender lead in the championship, with Carlos Sainz and Colin McRae now snapping at his heels and Richard Burns beginning to mount a challenge in four. Greece's round of the World Championship will be run over 3 days and 20 rough stages, with day one consisting of 6 timed tests set to the north of Parnassos, the last a repeat of the first. As championship leader, Tommi Makinen had the dubious honour of being the first into the loose, dusty stages, and once he got started, he struggled for grip. 8th fastest on stage 1, 14th on the next. The Finn was down in 11th place and over 30 seconds off the lead after just 38 kilometres. Carlos Sainz followed Makinen through, and on a slightly cleaner road, fared slightly better. He was 5th. Teammate McRae, 6th. Richard Burns was fastest on the opening stage, but only 6th on the next to leave him in 3rd. But Peugeot star Didier Auriol didn't even finish the first stage as clutch failure intervened.
Of course, we are disappointed, you know. I was expecting to make quite a nice season, but okay, still not over completely, but for the championship, it starts to be very, very hard. That's clear.
Bad luck.
Thank you.
French compatriot François Delacour was still in the rally, but his Ford Focus was way down in 24th after having to struggle through stage one with a shredded rear tyre. Hardly what the doctor ordered after he'd fallen off his bike the day before and badly sprained his right wrist.
I had a puncture because I had a problem yesterday on the bike and with the arm, and it's a bit painful. Then I think I was not so precise in the first stage and I had a puncture. Suddenly at the middle of the stage, I finished the stage like that.
With only 4 points from a miserable year, world champion Marcus Gronholm at least had a cleaner surface to drive on, and he lay second. It was Petter Solberg, though, who was quickest on stage two and claimed the early lead, while Estonian Marco Martin returned to the Subaru camp and lay an impressive fourth. Alistair McRae may have had the best of the conditions in his Hyundai, but he didn't have the best of luck, and turbo problems left him a lowly 18th as the crews headed for their first service in Parnassos.
Richard, quickest on the first stage, you quickest on the second. So what is it, the car, the tyres, the man?
No, to tell the truth, I'm not trying to improve anything. It's now we may have to slow down a little bit. It's quite boring because it's all the tactics. It's better to just go flat out, but that's life.
So you're not going to be playing tactics, you're going to push?
No, I'm going to play tactics, yeah. We have to.
Everyone's talking about tactics of slowing down, but there is another tactic, and that's going flat out and opening up a gap.
Yes, but it seems to be difficult to take a gap also, so it's not so big advantage now to be second, third on the road if you look at the times.
So is fourth on the road the place to be?
It's a good place, I think, because I think there's probably quite a lot of stones being pulled out when you get further back, because even I've had to slow down on a couple of the corners in that first stage because there were some big rocks pulled out, and it's better to drive around at this stage of the rally than risk damaging the car.
The next two stages weren't a happy hunting ground for the French teams. Harry Rovanperä gave Peugeot a glimmer of hope, third on stage three, but even as he swapped tyres before stage four, his team leader was out after hitting an innocent-looking rock around 10 kilometres into stage three.
Viis, oikealle ja vasen hidas. No niin, oikealle ja vasen hidas. Kuus ja oikein nopea.
Co-driver Timo Rautiainen's gesture says it all. That stone had holed the car's sump, and so yet another retirement for the world champions.
It's really difficult now. I don't believe how difficult it is. Even now, I think more than unlucky now. Really, really.
Is that it for the championship?
Yes, I think so. Now it seems to be really, really bad for the championship, so I cannot say anything.
With both nominated drivers out, Peugeot boss Corrado Prevera wasn't having a good day. Things weren't much better over at Citroën. Thomas Rodstrom and co-driver Tina Turner had been setting some top six times, but an electrical failure meant they wouldn't return to Itea. It had, though, been an encouraging start for the gravel-spec Zara. Teammate Philippe Bugalski is more at home on asphalt, and a stomach bug meant the Frenchman's mind wasn't always on his driving. Subaru's Toshi Arai was another victim of the conditions, retiring with suspension failure on stage four, but the team still had plenty to smile about. Richard Burns was sixth fastest on stage three, obviously concerned about his road position, but it was Marco Martin who was fastest, his first stage win, so it was now a Subaru 1-2-3, with Solberg leading from Martin and Burns in third place. Colin McRae, though, couldn't care less about road positions. He set the fastest time on stage four to move into third place, ahead of Burns.
Four left plus into three left minus. And six right opens into three right.
People are starting now to talk about tactics. What are yours?
As fast as possible.
You don't care about where you're on the road tomorrow?
No, it's
at the end of the day, it's not going to make any difference in this rally. Not in the position I'm in at the moment. If we're leading tonight, then good and well.
Marco, you're second behind Petter now. A good morning's work.
Yeah, it has been quite good for us. I mean, it has been reasonably easy because we are running so far behind. Only the first stage was really rough for us. That road was destroyed already, but all the rest of the stages we have had a really good surface.
Kenneth Eriksson left the service area down in 66th place after more Hyundai turbo problems. Teammate Alistair McRae was still going in 15th, but for the Swede, the painful experience would soon be over.
Go again, Kenneth.
Completely without power steering after 4 kilometers, and absolutely zero boost, no boost whatsoever.
With stage 5 cancelled due to overcrowding, Tommi Makinen finally had a cleaner run on stage 6, a repeat of the first, and he went 4th fastest. Colin Sykes also had his best result of the day. He was 2nd fastest and leapt from 6th to 2nd, despite a few minor dramas in the stage and on the way home. Colin McRae was quickest and stormed into the lead, helped by the Subaru management telling Richard Burns what time to set to stay behind the Fords for day 2.
34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44.
Unfortunately, neither Solberg nor Martin could help as they dropped behind Burns.
Colin, you're leading tonight. Something of a surprise?
No, not really, not at all. We were sure the Subaru were going to play around a bit, and they did, so it's up to them. They've dropped quite a bit of time, though.
I was going to say, is that a mistake, do you think? You're now something like 40 seconds up.
Well, for sure we're going to have a bit of a disadvantage in places tomorrow, but I'm not really that worried about it. Over the 2 days, I don't think it's going to make a big difference.
We have to do the last stage without ALS, with manual shifting, without fly-by-wire. With one moose broken, the clutch stuck in the bottom, it was one of those stages really, you are so happy to finish, and I thought really the rally was over before, so I'm delighted to be here.
Richard, was that a case of team orders which went slightly wrong?
No, both. I think both Marco and Petter had problems. I'm not sure. I think Marco just didn't have a good stage, but Petter certainly had a problem. His car was jammed in gear.
You're something like 33 seconds down on Colin this evening. Is that a problem?
It's perfect position, you know, because it's not really a problem. Even if we were 45 seconds or something behind over the rally, over the next 2 days, we can get that. The important thing for us is to be behind them on the road tomorrow.
In just one stage, the leaderboard had been turned upside down. Solberg and Martin dropped to 5th and 4th as McRae, Sykes and Burns rose to the top.
Leg 2's 7 stages lay first to the west and then southeast of Parnassos. Only 3 of those 7 were repeats, so McRae would be sweeping the gravel on the remaining 4. Stage 7, the day's first, was a rerun of stage 4, and so McRae saw a golden opportunity. Sure enough, he was quicker than both Sainz and Burns. Sainz didn't take the attacking line favoured by his colleague, and the cautious approach cost him around 10 seconds over those first 2 stages. Burns and Robert Reed would seize their chance on stage 8. 3.5 seconds up on Sainz and nearly 7 quicker than McRae, the gap from first to third was now 26.7 seconds.
Sorry, flat right, 100, flat left, 20, easy left, 40, fast left, long, to fast left.
However, the decision not to stop for a puncture meant retirement for Marco Martin with broken suspension. A bitter blow.
I really don't know what I've done wrong, so I'm really surprised that it happened again.
That left Petter Solberg as the sole backup for Burns. The Norwegian still a solid fourth, but over 26 seconds behind his team leader. The man in fifth place was Rovan Pera, the first Michelin shod runner, both Fords and both Subarus running on Pirelli tyres. But by now another team on the French rubber were down to one car.
Yeah, we had some problem with the turbo boost. It was too slow pickup and the boost wasn't there, what it should have been. So I haven't been very lucky in this rally.
At the Parnassos service park after stage 8, there was time to reflect on the various battles going on, not just the scrap between the top 3.
Everyone's looking at the battle between Richard and Colin, but there's a good fight between you, Petter, and the rest around you.
So we everybody pushing very hard, and we will see what happens today. And now is hope we keep car on the road and try the best.
Still, we are wondering where what's something is wrong with, because we cannot be fast enough. We have a little bit something missing.
Makinen's mysterious lack of pace was rattling everyone, it seemed, even the normally well-drilled Mitsubishi mechanics.
Stages 9, 10 and 11 would be run before the next service, and Carlos Sainz was fastest on both 9 and 11, taking just over 10 seconds off McRae's lead. Stage 10 was shortened to a mere 3.6 kilometre sprint, leaving Burns with even less time to catch up. He'd actually lose 0.4 of a second to the Scot here, and over the three stages he'd clawed back just 4 seconds. Things weren't going the Englishman's way.
Ridiculous place for a flying finish.
Makinen was as spectacular as ever, but seemed unable to get his Mitsubishi on the pace, even with cleaner conditions. Alistair McRae's woes continued with a broken driveshaft that flailed around and sheared a hydraulic pipe, and he plummeted from 12th to 24th. François Delacour's day went from brilliant to bad. Having won 3 out of 4 stages, he'd risen from 12th to 7th. But then the power steering failed, and with only one good arm, he dropped back to 10th.
Your wrist is still not well. It must have been terrible for you that last stage.
Yeah, for sure. And after on the support section, Daniel was driving because it was very painful on the stage.
How is the wrist now?
I think it should be all right. We'll see.
We had a 30-second lead over Richard and 21 over Carlos last night, and it's 14 and 23 respectively now, so we're not doing too bad.
I think it's fair to say that we couldn't have done the times that Colin's doing, so, you know, maybe for Colin the decision's right, and maybe for us the decision's right, but we'll see tomorrow night. I mean, that's what we're all aiming for. It's not what's happening now.
With a frustrated Makinen a distant 6th, Harry Rovanperä in 5th place might have been over a minute and 13 seconds behind the leader, but under 13 behind the man in 4th place, so had every reason to continue to push. His target was Solberg, 3rd fastest on both stages 12 and 13, and so equally as determined to hang on to that 4th place. 46 seconds ahead of Solberg lay Burns, quickest on stage 13. Less than 15 seconds now covered the top 3 places. Sainz was still 2nd, but the gap between the two focuses was now less than 10 seconds. It seemed McRae's gamble had paid off. Running first on the road wasn't the handicap it had been in Cyprus. Another day remained, however, and both Sainz and Burns were in strong positions to threaten. Whatever happened, the scene was set for a thrilling finale. So has the day gone according to plan?
More or less, yeah. I mean, it wasn't a surprise that we lost a bit of time today, but I think, considering the conditions, you know, it's quite a good time.
The fact that here in Greece the three drivers were separated just by less than 15 seconds, so how good are the cars, and you know how tight is the competition even in a rough situation like this rally.
It's going to be hard because Colin's done a good job today. Even though he's been first car, he's still managed to do some good times, so we know we're going to have to push very hard all day, but That's what you have to do to win rallies, so that's what we're going to do.
9.8 seconds the gap between McRae and Sainz. Burns a further 5 behind. Solberg and Rovanperä looked set to scrap for 4th, while Makinen had one eye on a charging Delacour, who was 7th.
Day 3 promised the tightest battle of the year. 3 superstars head-to-head over 7 stages, and perhaps crucially, 5 of them were being run for a second time. The first two were the new ones, and it was here that McRae was most vulnerable, running as road sweeper for his rivals. His answer? 2nd fastest on both stages. Sainz was charging, but could only manage a 3rd and a 4th. But Burns won stage 14 and was now just 2.2 seconds behind the Spaniard. Petter Solberg also proved the Subaru was the car to have, as he won stage 15 and put another 18 seconds between himself and the chasing pack, led by Harry Rovanperä. The Finn's only consolation was that he was winning the Michelin race, but he hadn't given up trying. Tommi Makinen was second best Michelin runner, but he was falling further back all the time, still unable to get the grip he wanted, and frustrated even further when co-driver Risto Mäkinen lost his place in the pace notes. While Tommy described the route ahead, Risto tried to find the matching notes. Tommy's main worry, he knew there was a big jump just round one of the corners ahead. After a promising fifth place in Cyprus, Freddy Loix was also struggling in his Mitsubishi, but without a 2-minute road penalty, he would have been just one place behind Makinen. Instead, he was 11th, which became 10th when Gilles Panizzi's Peugeot expired. 8 kilometres into stage 15, and unofficial split times suggested Burns is not only ahead of Sainz, but catching McRae. And just after Robert Reed calls a tight right-hander ahead,
right.
The crew get the message on a pit board.
Major left.
This lot.
Come on!
No way, we're stopping here, man.
He went off and now he's coming back.
Richard!
What's up?
How do you know?
He's a Billy Joy there.
Back!
Well, he's changed the puncture or gone off.
Did they see?
You can't see, yeah. The 3 minutes is about.
Hello.
Stop it to change.
Now, division life, tight into maybe 20, easy right, 50.
Lost 3 minutes.
But don't you think there's a possibility that he may have been distracted by the information?
I don't think we'll ever know whether it did or not. Say Richard made a mistake, he was going flat out, and I think it could have been any corner from what he says. You know, it's noisy in the car, there's a lot of distraction, not just split time boards and so on. And I think, under that, at that speed, this sort of thing happens.
Very disappointing, but in a way, I'm trying absolutely everything to try to win the rally, and of course sometimes you make mistakes. That's it.
But perhaps this was just too much information to take in, just yards before a critical corner. The only physical damage was a broken prop shaft, but the mental damage was much, much more.
Do you think team orders will be applied now?
Not at the moment, no. Petter's very close behind and he's going very quickly as well. There's still a long way to go.
No team orders meant McRae and Grist couldn't relax. And sure enough, going into the event's final 38-kilometre stage, just 5.9 seconds would separate the Fords. Burns and Reed were struggling just to score a single point now, but their fortunes would take a further nosedive. The new prop shaft, it seemed, was the weakest link.
50 flat right, to flat right, tight into the prop, baby. Broken. 20 flat left, plus.
Now going fire.
Tell me about it.
What? Turn around, you want.
Yeah.
Okay. Supervision for Richard, the prop's broken on the start line. We're just going slowly through the stage. What do you want us to do?
Drive slowly to safety.
Broken at the rear. Yeah, Richard, if it's broken at the rear, confirm that, then we can do the same point.
Okay, stopping.
We just on the start line of this stage, the prop shaft broken. If we carried on like that, where it's broken is very near the fuel tank, so we didn't want to risk carrying on. We could maybe have finished the stage, but to then go and do a 40-kilometre stage would have been very dangerous.
Peter Solberg and Phil Mills, meanwhile, were having their own far less serious problems.
Line into one left bus.
30, line into one left, last tightens.
Solberg driving to finish meant this was now a Ford Fiesta. One stage remained, but it had been run before, so McRae wasn't at a disadvantage. A straight fight, and still no team orders. McRae went first, now on the verge of his third successive victory, and unaware of one last piece of drama the event had up its sleeve. Behind the fight for victory, a delighted Philippe Bugalski scored a point on Citroën's first gravel event with the Zara World Rally Car. Still nursing his sore wrist, François Delacour had to settle for second best in his scrap with Makinen. Tommy himself would earn 3 points, but was far from happy with the car, the tyres, and his own performance. Rovampero would salvage some pride for Peugeot, keeping his own hopes of the driver's title alive by finishing on the podium, while Petter Solberg would return to Etea in second place, his best ever performance helped by an incident on the last stage. On board with Sainz and Moya, and it's soon obvious all is not well. Ten kilometres into the stage, and with a sick engine, Sainz is forced to stop and radio the team with the bad news.
I'm suddenly starting three cylinders. I think it's a mistake. Then after a while, I lost the oil pressure. And now I stop.
The message quickly gets through to McRae and Grist that they can afford to back off. This time, the radio message gets a slightly different response. 30,
6 left, 70. Okay. I'm getting used to this. Well done.
This was McRae's 23rd World Rally victory, and one which makes him joint equal at the top of the list of event winners. He shares that honour, incidentally, with Juha Kankkonen and Carlos Sainz.
Colin, very well done. 3 wins out of 3. How do you feel?
Great, delighted. It's been a fairly major turnaround.
You said to us before Argentina that maybe a couple of wins from the next 3 events would be handy. Did you think that 3 out of 3 was attainable?
Well, obviously that's what we were going to try and do, but you know, it's difficult enough to win one event, never mind 3 in a row. So, I mean, we're delighted and we'll just try and keep the ball rolling as long as we can.
Petter, very well done. How do you feel?
Hi, great. It's the biggest moment in my life, definitely.
Phil, something of history being made. Welsh co-drivers first and second.
That's right, first and second. That does make history. Let's hope that it's the first of quite a few, but perhaps we'll swap the places next time with Nick.
The final results made it look like a Colin McRae cruise, with Scandinavia's 2 newest stars coming home ahead of their multi-world champion Tommi Makinen, the brave Delacour, and a buoyant Bugalski. Having led the championship since winning the season's opener in Monte Carlo, Makinen now shares the points lead with McRae, but the Scot goes top as he has 3 wins, the Finns 2. In the manufacturer's table, Ford increased their lead over Mitsubishi, but only by 4 points, as Loitz picked up a couple with his 8th place, while Skoda move ahead of Hyundai with their cars finishing 7th and 10th.
So, a hat-trick of victories for Colin McRae, but for Richard Burns, this time no second place, not even a single point. With 7 events gone and 7 more to go, 5 drivers have an eye on the world title. Round 8 takes the series from the Greek mountains to the plains of East Africa for Kenya's Safari Rally.